That's good to hear that part. And you were saying even with the bent connecting rod, it was running. Like, I mean.
Oh yeah, he rode for probably 3-4 years with a bent connecting rod. He said it smoked for a couple months afterwards, but you know. But we checked the pistons for piston skirt wear, and that's where you would identify if you have a bent connecting rod, and that's not excessive wear on any of the piston skirts. And so that would be your identifier if you've got a serious issue.
All right, so we're going to assemble a 1993 R100 Paris Dakar, very similar to the one that I raced in the Mint 400, and that's currently in my collection. You'll see ground up, engine assembly, and hopefully we'll have this running by part three, maybe part two.
Just watching that. Phil blew up something else.
Oh, hey, morning.
Huh? We're filming right now. Hello, I'm Jay. How can I help you, Mr. Nate?
Oh,
yeah.
All right. Oh, hold on. We're going to do it. We'll do it proper.
Yeah, that's right. Your best Australian accent.
All right, mate. We'll come with me down to the outback. We're going to fucking spin around here. Everybody, jump in the rover.
It's pretty good.
Is that Australian?
I don't want somewhere.
Then the
Crikey! That's not a knife. That's all I know.
Remember, what was that? Crocodile down there. He's like, hello, welcome to Wendy's. Hello, Wendy.
I have a buddy that was born in the UK, raised in Australia, and spent his adult life in New Zealand.
I thought you were going to throw South Africa in there, because that's another place.
That's...
I changed my Siri to South African Siri because... I'm used to hearing Norm talk to me all the time, so I'm like, well, Siri might as well be the same.
So you have every part essentially build this back up.
Yeah.
I mean...
Well, up north, you're going to have to talk like a Wisconsinite, eh?
Wow.
Yes. Oh, I tell you what, I spent so much time in the North Woods. The women up there, they tell you two things in the winter. There's only two things to do. Chop wood and fuck, and I don't chop wood.
So this guy's the brainchild behind all these motorcycle parts and gaskets and everything you could give a little...
Everything BMW motorcycle from literally every version, but we're really heavy in the airheads, but we have pretty much everything from the early R19s all the way up to the... even some parts that'll fit the new R1300 GSs. So, but mostly, primarily, airhead is our main focus. Airheads, oilheads, K bikes, early Ks, and so forth. But this bike was a local Denver bike that I bought from a friend of mine. Got too old to ride. He rode this bike from Denver to Cabo San Lucas up to Alaska and back. So it's seen its fair share of the Western United States. It came in with a... I bought it and it was leaking a lot because the seals were all shot and your typical top end reseal. But when I got into it, I identified that one of the connecting rods was bent. So
how did that happen?
He was going over a mountain pass and dropped the bike on the side and it hydrolocked the left piston. And he's like, yeah, now that you mention it, it smoked for a while after that. So
he's still riding it with it.
Yeah. And so it was always a perfect little S curve to it. But we put a new connecting rod into it.
They all have a little bend. It's okay.
BenCarrick.com. That'll help you.
Anyway. What would you say the mileage is on this? Rough guess.
Rough guess, probably 120,000. Yeah.
Miles.
Yeah. 120,000. Yeah. So it's not original mileage on it. He's had some issues with the tack keeping mileage, or the odometer keeping mileage, the speedometer, and so forth. But these things are pretty bulletproof. The crank bearings are good for a million miles. When I opened it up, we checked the connecting rod bearings. The connecting rod bearings were good. Did not change those. Inspected them, of course. Put new ones in on... No, I did put new connecting rod bearings in because I replaced the left connecting rod. And we've just been cleaning this bike like crazy. because that's 90% of the job of rebuilding one of these bikes is cleaning. So just clean. Pulled off the jugs. I've rehoned the cylinders. It's got a Nicosil coating on the cylinders from the factory, so those are pretty much last forever. But they do need to be cut with a hone in order to get the new rings to seal. So we're gonna put new piston rings on the pistons, get it all prepped for a top end reseal, slide the pistons into the sleeves, sleeves onto the studs, set the gudgeon pins or wrist pins, and then we'll be able to finish mounting up the pistons and cylinders. We'll torque down the heads, we'll let it rest for a little bit, let everything tack up. Then we'll do our valve clearance checks, set our valves. Thanks, Jeff.
Well, now we got two bikes through.
It wasn't me, Your Honor.
No, it's all good. It's all good. Leave it right there. It can't fall out of the sky. So, once we get done with the top end, we'll throw the timing cover back on, and then we'll probably throw on a new alternator. We'll get a big permanent magnet alternator on there, and just put everything back together. And carbs have already been rebuilt, so there is a chance that we'll have this running tonight.
Now, this is a majority of the parts to this bike.
Yeah. Yep.
And yep. These are obviously the cylinder heads. So.
Cylinder heads, pistons in right here. So we'll put new piston rings on.
Okay.
Slide them in the cylinder sleeves, get all the gaskets on there, mount them, put all the valves, rockers, assemblies back on, torque that all on. So then that's all the top end. Carbs have been all rebuilt. I just finished rebuilding those today with Matt Isles. Air box has all been cleaned and prepped, so the air box is ready to go back on. Oil pans cleaned and prepped. Starter covers cleaned and prepped. And this is the front engine cover. And so we'll put new gaskets in there, and we'll put a whole new alternator on it. We'll probably throw a crank-fired ignition on this as well. So we'll change out the coil and put a more modern digital ignition. It originally came with the transistorized ignition system, which is the Hall sensor inside what we call a bean can ignition module. Very similar to the standard ignition system setup that you'd find on a Volkswagen Bug and so forth. But we're going to go with a full digital ignition system mounted on the crank. And because this is an adventure bike, I'm going to take an older contact point style bean can,
okay,
and mount it in place of the Hall sensor bean can. So we have a secondary contact point ignition system installed on the bike, ready to go. And if we ever do experience ignition failure in the deep woods or wherever, all you gotta do is change one wire at the coil and you can run a contact point system on it.
So you have like a double redundancy then?
Yeah.
Wow.
Because we're putting
a double
in,
redundancy?
I mean a single redundancy, not double. Well, so then if you did.
Yeah.
Sorry,
sir,
one redundancy.
Not to repeat myself to be redundant, but.
Sorry, one. Redundancy.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay.
So we're going to try to, I don't know if we'll get all the electronics mounted tonight. It goes real fast. I mean, I wrote the book on the installation books, and I used this bike in particular for most of the photographs in my installation books. So it's kind of bittersweet. I like having this bike around just to have it to test fit things to. But eventually these need to go on the road. They need to get back to life and ridden. So it's been sitting for 3 years on my lift, and I'm ready to take this off my lift and time to start building show bikes. So,
and I mean, a lot of people, I mean, I did a video on mine and it went through the Min 400 unfazed, and like other brand new bikes were completely broke down. I mean, these are obviously bulletproof bikes, but rebuilding it kind of increases the longevity, obviously. What about the transmission? Are those pretty stout? Would you touch anything on that?
No, it's very stout. If you have an issue, maintenance is of course important.
Yeah.
If you're not changing your final drive fluid and so forth like that, if you don't change your tire and lube your splines, you can have spline wear. But if it's maintained, I have no qualms about buying an Airhead with 100,000 miles on it. It's still got a lot of life left into it. And you can put a modest amount of money into it and still have a very reliable bike. When this is done, no reason why you wouldn't drive this to the Atlantic Ocean and then back to the Pacific.
Wow. That's good to hear that part. And you were saying even with the bent connecting rod, it was running.
Oh, yeah. He rode for probably 3-4 years with a bent connecting rod. He said it smoked for a couple months afterwards, but you know. But we checked the pistons for piston skirt wear, and that's where you would identify if you have a bent connecting rod, and that's not excessive wear on any of the piston skirts. And so that would be your identifier if you've got a serious issue with a bent connecting rod.
But you didn't really see that.
So the sleeves looked, the cylinders looked good, the pistons didn't have any piston skirt wear, piston slap that we would be suspect to. So clean it up, put it in.
Sweet. So, all right. Well,
you tell me why you like BMW.
Why do I like BMW? Because it broke man's wallet. BMW. Or big Mexican woman.
Bring more wrenches.
Bring more wrenches.
Bring more wallet.
You heard it.
Or there is
the black man's wish.
Black man. Thanks for saying that one, bro. I'm biting my tongue.
Wait a minute. How long have you known that since I come in here?
See where the gap is.
I can find one. I know exactly what you're talking about. I was looking for one of those immediately, but I'm at the shop. And, you know, everyone's got their tools wherever. I've got one at home. I went through Bart's box, went through.
All right, I got to have you explain.
It's for 2 seconds. Truly.
All right, so you're setting the piston rings onto.
So right now we're going to put some new piston rings on these pistons. Before you ever change the piston rings, you want to have your cylinders honed. So there's a nice crosshatch that's been cut into these with a ball hone. Typically done with a good lubricant in a solvent tank. Once you're skilled at it, you can put a drill and a ball hone and time your in and out properly to get a crosshatch. And I forget the technical degree angle you want, but that's what it is, because I took note of what we wanted to do for the angle of the crosshatch. If you don't crosshatch your cylinders when you're putting new piston rings on, you have a chance of the piston rings not seating. So you need them crosshatched in order to wear the piston rings initially so that you get a good piston seal.
And the variant of rings that you have here, what are?
These are genuine Goetz for this model. Can't really screw it up. They have the instructions and pictures on how to put them on. So you just want to make sure you don't ever line up all the gaps in your pistons rings, because then you're creating a gap for blow-by. So just follow the directions and how they tell you to put them in. There's your oil scraper, and then you've got the two, I don't know if they call them compression rings technically, but so that's how you do that. So once we start getting these all inspected, make sure they're all good, make sure the oil scraper off to the right side. What we want to do is we want to end gap our piston rings. And so end gapping them is really easy to do. You just go ahead and take a piston. WD-40 is always your friend on this, because just throw some WD-40 around, loosen it, loop it all up. You throw a piston ring in it, and then you square it with the piston to make sure you're not crooked. Now we can measure the end gap of the piston ring with a feeler gauge.
And here's, so my buddy, Bubba.
All right, so now we're going to put the pistons in the cylinders. It's always easy to put the pistons in from the bottom because the cylinder is a little bit wider and flared right there versus trying to drop it from the top. The top is a hard edge and it's perfectly tight. You have a little more breathing room on the bottom. So you can use the lubricant, you can use oil. I just use WD-40. It's plenty good for what we're doing. We're just trying to make sure that everything's got a little bit of lube. Orientate my piston proper. This is the bottom, because that's where the cam's on the bottom of the engine. We're going to go ahead and gap the piston rings. Make sure they're in the proper positions. We got one there, we got one there, we got one there. So that looks like even thirds to me on position. So we're just going to go ahead and take it. We're just going to slowly just work our way in, one ring at a time. So we'll go ahead and just work that one in.
So, and then we're doing the whole, pay attention.
Once we compress that, you can use a piston ring compressor, but you really don't have to.
You really don't have to.
That's exactly why you were staring like that.
You can get it by hand.
Hey, we're filming here.
Oh, are we filming back?
No, I'm just kidding. You can use a recompressor, but you really don't have to.
Where's light?
Let me just wash this down real quick.
Okay.
So, yeah, you can use a ring compressor, but you really don't have to. You can do it all by hand. It's just a little finicky, all right?
And he's like, well, he's like, I pulled you guys over because some of the locals were like,
compressor hardly know.
What are you gonna do about these guys busting through acid, you know, mock speed or whatever? The police officer's like, yeah, a couple of you guys got airborne back.
See, there's the first piston ring. That's it. Oh, and it's out.
That's a great curve.
And that's the ins and outs of this.
Okay.
Let's go for the morning. Don't fuck him up.
Good, fast, and cheap. I'm good and I'm cheap.
Pick two.
Pick two.
Alright, that's all the action you're gonna get.
Okay, so now we have the pistons set into the cylinders. Let me take a snap ring pliers and we can get access to the wrist pin or gudgeon pin, right? I pre-marked the cylinder with an arrow pointing towards the front of the motorcycle. It's also on the piston top, which you can't really see down in there, it's dark, but there's an arrow just to the right side of the exhaust valve cutout. You can see it better on this piston. There's a little arrow just to the inside of the, towards the center of the exhaust valve. Okay, so now we've got our pistons rings are all set. It's sitting inside. Now we're gonna use all of our top end gasket kit to go ahead and start putting some of the gaskets on it. Not all BMW airheads use the white cylinder base O-ring. If they have the groove on the bottom of the machining, it more than likely receives it. Unless you're doing a Siebenrock kit, which is not always the case. If you're doing a Siebenrock power kit, you use what was sent, because we have it all matched up to what Siebenrock recommends. So there's your cylinder base O-ring that we're installing.
Every time I say it, it was asked what?
The BMW uses, airheads use the top oil bolts as an oil passage. And that's how you get oil to your heads. Included in the kit as well are your O-rings that's going to seal the top end, which is all part of doing it. If even if you're not going to completely rebuild the engine, if you're just doing a top end reseal, this is part of doing a top end reseal. You want to make sure that those O-rings are on and in a good place. Some people will take a little dab of a ultra black gasket material. The Permatex is good because it doesn't get hard. It stays nice and soft and supple even when it's installed. So remember, this is an oil passage, so we don't want to go crazy on it, but it's not uncommon to take just a smidgen and put that on that O-ring to keep it in its place. So we're talking just a little tiny bit. It just kind of keeps it where you want it. But we're relying on the gasket, not the gasket material. So now this whole side is all pretty much prepped. We've got our push rod tubes under, right on this side. And that's where our camshaft's spinning. Tappets are riding on the camshaft. Push rod tubes are going through this tube out to our rockers to operate our valves. So we got our push rod tubes. So we can put our push rod tubes on. Some people say put them on dry. Some people say use a little sealant on them. They're technically supposed to be installed with simply just a little bit of a silicone type lubricant. I like to use a very thin layer of ultra black, thin, like think latex paint. That's about, because whatever you put on, whatever squishes out, squishes in. So you don't ever want to over, more is not better, but just the right amount. And then we've got to get these all rotated right and everything and get this ready to get on. But now we're pretty much have our cylinder with our cylinder sleeve ready to install, and onto the bike, and we can move on from there.
All right, Matt, what are we doing here?
Well, I'm just getting everything ready so when we start filming, it's all good to go.
Oh, okay.
Or you're not filming now, are you?
Oh, I definitely am.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Hey, look over here.
So we're going to get ready to put on these cylinders and sleeves and the whole top end onto this R100 GSPD. Couple things you want to check if you're in this far. You want to check your tappets. Tappets right on the camshaft, so you want to check and see if they're worn at all. So the best way to do that is you just take a paper clip. You just bend a little hook at the tip of it, and you're able to take the paper clip and stick it right inside the center hole of the tappet that the oil goes through, and you can pull the tappet right out. I've already done this, and I've inspected them all, and I've gone ahead and thoroughly coated them with assembly lube. So you want to pull that out, and you want to get a good look at the surface of that tappet. If you're looking for any pitting or any wear that's on the surface of that, surface should be just like a mirror, because this is what's riding on that lobe of the camshaft. So the camshaft's coming around with his lobes, and is riding on that. So that's going to connect to the pushrod to the rocker, to the valve, and that's how your whole valves function. So I've already gone through all the rockers. They look real good. If you're going to go ahead and pull them, you want to put a good, I like the Liqui Moly LM48. Is a very nice lubricant
you
to put
sell
on
that,
them.
Right?
Yep, we sell that, so that's available. So it's high in millennium content, and millennium is what's really the good part of it. So don't need to go crazy. You just want to, you can lubricate every surface, and as well as the face, because that's what's riding on the camshaft. So you want to put some lubricant on the camshaft straight away. So you just lubricate all the surfaces and get it all ready to go back in, and they just go right back in. If they are showing any signs of pitting or wear, you definitely want to replace them, because that's going to cause your camshaft to wear. So that's all put into place. Our tappets are all good. They're all lubricated, so they're all ready to ride nicely.
Are the camshafts pretty stout on these?
Camshafts are very stout on them. You can change them to performance camshafts. I'm working on getting some camshafts made for performance reasons, but stock camshafts, more than adequate. So,
excellent.
We've got our cylinder connecting rod hanging right now. So we're gonna go ahead and prep this whole cylinder to slide right onto it. We've already go ahead and got our oil passage rings, because the oil passes through the top bolts all the way out to the heads. So that's how you get oil all the way out to the heads on these engines, is through the top. There's a very small little notch on the top of each bolt. That's where the oil comes out to the top. So through that little hole, oil is pumped through the passage all the way out to the heads, and that's how you get oil to the valve rockers. So we've already put the cylinder pistons in. I've got them all lined up, matched, arrow forward, so we know we're good. So we're ready to put this on. Some people just go, depending on the year, if you have that base O-ring, we talked about that, oil passage O-rings. I like to put a little bit of sealant. You don't go crazy on this. Whatever comes out goes in. So if you've got this built up too much, it's going to be squirting out. But you apply a very thin layer. I always say, like you're painting with latex paint. You want a very thin layer on it. So we're going to go ahead and get a very thin layer of Ultra Black Permatex. The reason why I choose Ultra Black is it stays malleable. It doesn't get hard. There's different trains of thoughts as far as what's the best sealant to use. You can use Dribon or Holemeyer.
It seems like in the past 10 years, the Permatex Ultra Black has kind of taken the cake as like a replacement for almost anything.
It's a very good product. Very good product. I don't even sell it, and I'm going to say it's just a good thing. As Martha Stewart would say, it's a good thing. So, We're just going to slowly work on one side at a time. We're going to replicate the entire process for the other side of the engine. But it's the same. It's a opposed engine, easy to replicate one side to the other.
It's a boxer.
It's a boxer. All right.
One side is just like the other.
So I am not going crazy with the amount that I'm putting on here. I'm keeping it very minimal because more is not better. Obviously, this is cosmetic. You don't want to get it out to where everybody sees it. So I'm going to go ahead and just keep that nice and clean. I'm not trying to go crazy here, just get a little on. Take care to not booger up too much on the oil passages, because if you plug the oil passages, you're tearing it all apart to start again.
Quite shortly.
So I've already used my snap ring pliers, removed the piston circlip from that side, so now the piston circlip is removable. And we don't necessarily have to remove it completely out of the bike, out of the piston, I should say, but we do need to move it out in order to receive the connecting rod. I use cable ties because this bike has been sitting for a while, but you could have used rubber bands. Don't let that drop, because you can nick it.
The surface, yeah.
And so before I throw that on there, the other thing I like to do, and this is debatable, some people say don't put a gasket material on the pushrod tube seals. Some people say you just oil it. That's the way BMW intended it. I will put a very small, thin layer.
For something that famously leaks super fast into service.
Right.
I'll have to agree with you.
And you can see I'm not using much.
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. Always remember, what squishes out, squishes in. You don't want an oil pan full of silicone, because that's no bueno.
Yeah.
All right. So super light layer, technically not even needed, but it's just that little bit layer of protection. We're ready to go ahead and put this cylinder on. Make sure our oil passage O-rings are still in place. They all look good. And it's like operation. That down.
I got it.
Very good. I got it. So now I'm gonna run my head around this way and line up the little end with the piston ring. And this is always a little finicky.
Threading needle.
Right, quite literally.
Come a little higher with the little end.
I gotta come around. That's feeling good. I got it. There we go. Make sure the piston slides out from a little bit. Got a little deep.
There she is.
Some of these airheads use a circlip that sits into the piston. The later ones use a typical. It's not really common for a piston circlip to sit on the outside like this, but that's what BMW settled on. Who am I to disagree? There you hear the snap. You know that's in. So now you can slide that right in. We don't have to worry about rotating the engine to get that in. piston will slide.
On this side, you want to make sure the clutch cable's out of the way.
Yep. On these pushrod tube seals, there is a little line on them which points down, which I already made sure that they were put in the right place. So
and there she is.
There you go. And there, you are very close to being sealed up.
There's your piston jug.
All right. Now, the one thing I didn't show is I went ahead and I used the brake cleaner in a nice cloth. I cleaned off all the gasket surfaces across the engine to make sure that we had nice clean surfaces that we're putting everything together. Always building an engine, 90% of it is cleaning. So now we've got the piston set with the appropriate gaskets to make a top end seal. Pushrod tube seals are in. Now we need to start keep moving our way out. We're done with the Permatex, no more sealant. We only have to do that on the engine side. So now we're looking at bolting this down and securing it tight. We've got a cylinder base gasket, right? So there is obviously the bottom side for the pushrod tube seals, front and back, so forth. See you, OJ.
See you later. Bye, OJ.
Bye. The Pandura and I are going to make our exit.
Thanks for coming to Bike Night.
Thank you for having us.
Cylinder base gasket gets slid in all the way. Very good. Everything. See, this is backwards.
Front to back.
It is sided.
So there is a front and a back to it. So take note of that. I could have done a lot of work to figure out the front wave the right way before I tried it, but there I did it. I know. Flip it around. Slide that on.
It's much more.
See?
Much more in line.
Now everything matches up.
Now your push rods can make it through.
Right. There's the Funduro going.
All right. So we got our cylinder base gasket out.
We're ready to slide on our cylinder head. Once we do a few more things, when you take a bike apart, it's always important to match up the parts that you take off to make sure they go back in the same spot. So when I dismantled this, I not only cable tied everything as it was assembled, you know, so I can keep everything together, but I also put the description as far as where it would be. Now, right back rocker, it could have been, you know, right intake.
You gotta get organized.
But you always want to put your pushrod tubes back in the same spot. Think of it as this way, is this engine's got about 100,000 plus miles on it. It's a long time that that ball has been sitting on that tappet wearing into place.
The camshaft, the pushrods, they all mate together.
Everything has been married together and worn together for years, so you've got the optimal contact. So if I were to put the pushrod tube in a different spot, I'm just going to induce a lot more wear. It's not going to damage it any more than just, you know, induce a lot more wear. So there we got our pushrod tube, and you can actually feel where it sits into the tappet. So I've already greased the end of the tappet, so I don't need to grease the end of the pushrod tubes. Now, oil will be flowing through those pushrod tubes, through the tappet, so now those are all sitting nice and good, all right? I'm gonna take our cylinder head. I've already gone through, wiped off all the surfaces very nicely, so they're very clean with brake cleaner. So now we're ready to go ahead and put the heads on the right way. Easy to tell because the big holes on the bottom to take the...
Who the fuck is playing with an RC car?
It sounds like an RC car.
I don't know, but that sounds pretty cool. Well, let's back that up.
I was going to say, maybe push rods are...
Right, let's put those in after we put the heads on.
Head first. Right,
there we go.
The push rods, because they're at an angle.
I'm getting ahead of myself.
But
boom. All right. Who says there's no fun in engine building? All right. So that's sitting on there. Now we can put our pushrod tubes in. You always want to put the pushrod tubes in the same spot. You mark out where they came. This is right rear pushrod. Now you could call it right intake. Probably better to call it intake and exhaust, but front and rear, doesn't matter. Potato, potato.
Oh, they fit.
So those are all sitting nice in there. Our head's already sitting on. Now, when I take things apart, I cable tie everything together so I know it's going back together the same way. Right back rocker.
So, he's back, something's wrong.
Right.
What'd you do?
I forgot
the phone. Oh, well, that's not catastrophic.
I could have called you.
Part, I always throw cable ties through to keep everything assembled the way I took it off, because parts like to be where they were, right? So I usually run cable ties through to just hold the entire assembly together. There's a lot to hold on to. There's a lot of moving parts in it, right? So you want to make sure that you keep everything together. You go ahead and put it on. Push rod tube arm towards the bottom. Slide it right on.
Yep.
Now we're just sealing the engine, getting it all compressed. When we go ahead and set our valve clearances, we're gonna back these bolts off, and we're gonna make sure that we get the appropriate amount of squish to the rockers. So you want a very fine gap. You can use the feeler gauge to measure it. If you have too big of a gap when you reseal this, your rockers are gonna be bouncing up and down, and you will hear that noise in the engine. So when the airhead engine is running, you'll hear that da-da-da-da-da-da excessive rocker noise. It's typically because we just didn't compress. Not only are we tightening everything in, we need to compress everything down so we get just enough for an oil film to let this rocker float and not make noise. So lots of times I get old airheads and that rocker is loose, and it's bouncing up and down, and the heads are really noisy. So that's one thing, if your heads are really noisy and you're hearing a lot of rocker slap, that's because they didn't squeeze these down appropriately to get the appropriate amount of
cylinder sleeve into the engine. So we just keep hopping around all the different points of contact. There's four engine stud bolts and two cylinder stud bolts. Technically, this bolt only connects the head to the cylinder. These four are what draws the whole thing in. So I always tighten these up along with it, but just kind of get crisscross all evenly. And we'll run down the torque. Now they say, you know, by the book, you run them all down. You run them all down, and then to say 10 newton meters, and then further, I just keep going even across to all the bore, all the way. I don't go crazy on everything.
Ooh.
Is our rocker off?
Yeah.
Yeah, no problem. So that's something to keep an eye on. Make sure our rocker doesn't get off.
It's in.
There you go.
Good catch. That are really tapped. Tap.
So we're not worrying about setting valve clearance or anything. We're just sealing the engine right now. So we're just going to get everything just kind of just started off. When we come back and set our valve clearances, that's when we'll make sure we set our appropriate gap on the rockers. They make one piece units and all different versions and so forth. There we go. Crisscross applesauce. We'll take a quick check. You know, everything is looking good. We don't have an excessive amount of gasket material coming out because we didn't go nuts putting it on there. Because whatever comes out goes in. All right, so just enough to make it a nice little seal on everything. Head gasket, it's nothing crazy that we're seeing out of that. So we just keep continuing. We're gonna torque this up to spec. We're just gonna let it sit for overnight. If you're in a shop and you're busy and you gotta turn bikes over, you don't let them sit as long as I do, but I have the luxury of time versus money. So once I get everything torqued down, I'm gonna go ahead and let it sit for overnight.
Everything's all. I'll let it sit.
All right, that's it for tonight. Thanks for coming to Bike Night.
Bikes!
Bikes! Burn my beer.
Bikes!
Best part about Bike Night? No bitches. Just bikes, bourbon, and beer.
I wish there were
bitches. Bitches make a mess of everything.
I wish there were bitches.
There we go. That whole side is now sealed. So
R100 Paris Dakar, engine assembly part one.
Yeah.
All right, would you call this a soft overhaul or a refresh?
Definitely a serious refresh. We changed the connecting rod and then rehoned the cylinders, new piston rings, and then all the original components are still good. So we checked everything, it's all good. We're putting it all back together. We're gonna completely overhaul the electrical system. That's kind of my forte. So we're definitely gonna throw on some pretty exciting electrical components on here. Getting it running and solid is more important than any electrical component, because if it don't get you there, who cares if it charges?
Yeah, so, you don't need anything that charges anyways. It's got to get you there.
Jay, this one's you?
Yeah, that's me.
So, got to have the V-roll.
Hi.
Oh, there's plenty. Plenty of V. I don't know if you got much A, but there's plenty of V.
Send me what you got.
I got you, boo.
Hey, say that again.
I got you, boo.
Give me that camera so I can start.
Oh, you got it.